Caleb, you might want to turn on your microphone.
Please feel free to stop by the table and talk to any of us after tonight's debate. Our website is another great source of information and also includes a link to our YouTube channel, which features videos of many previous debates. The web address for our website is listed on our brochures, which are also available in the lobby. The goal of tonight's debate is to analyze the evidence for and against the resurrection of Jesus Christ. Our two distinguished speakers will each address this issue, presenting divergent views. The structure of tonight's debate is as follows. Each speaker will be given 25 minutes to speak in defense of his chosen position. Next, there will be 20 minutes of discussion, during which the speakers may ask questions of one another. Questions will then be taken from the audience for about 35 minutes. Those 35 minutes do tend to pass very quickly, so I suggest forming your questions carefully and perhaps writing them down in the provided space in your programs during the debate. We will try to close by 9 o'clock with a 3 to 5 minute statement from each speaker. I'd now like to introduce our first speaker for tonight, Dr. Craig Blomberg. Dr. Blomberg has been on faculty at Denver Seminary since 1986. He is currently the Distinguished Professor of New Testament. Dr. Blomberg completed his PhD in New Testament at Aberdeen University in Scotland, focusing on the parables and writings in Luke and Acts. Before joining the faculty of Denver Seminary, he taught at Palm Beach Atlantic College and was a research fellow with Tyndale House in Cambridge. He is the author or editor of 20 books, among which are Making Sense of the New Testament and The Historical Reliability of the Gospels. His current areas of interest and research include the historical trustworthiness of the Bible, biblical teaching on money and stewardship, and the methods and rules for interpreting the Bible. Please give a warm welcome to Dr. Craig Blomberg.
Coming out on a night that I understand you have some sports competition. I think you made the better choice. I hope you think so too after the evening is done. I want to begin with what I doubt is disputed as a fact, namely that the New Testament authors believed that Jesus was bodily raised from the dead. The earliest of whom began writing, and roughly about AD 50, nearly exactly 20 years after Jesus' death, which was most likely in AD 30. The question arises then, where did this belief come from? If one disputes the conviction of New Testament writers, one needs to come up with an alternate explanation. There have been a variety of these throughout the centuries. some that have had their heyday but are not widely held today at all, would include the notion that Jesus swooned or became comatose or came extremely close to death, and in a world without the modern technology to determine exact points of death, he was placed in a tomb, still barely alive, and managed to recover and convince people that he had rose from the dead, notwithstanding the fact that he would have had to have been in extremely poor shape, and yet all the testimonies were that he appeared transformed and as a glorious being. Another view is perhaps the oldest. It is recorded in the Gospel of Matthew as the word that was spread to cover up the failure of the Roman guard to keep the tomb sealed. Namely, that Jesus' disciples came and stole the body. But if they did, then they would have known everything they were teaching was a lie. And most apparently went to martyrs' deaths. Not uncommon in the history of religion for people who strongly believe in a religious cause, but largely unheard of by those who know that they are wrong in what they are claiming. Yet another option, not widely held today, is that the women, all four Gospels acknowledge a small group of women as the first to the tomb in their sorrow, in their confusion, in the darkness just before dawn, in an area populated with many tombs, went to the wrong tomb, found it empty, and so the story was perpetuated. But then all the authorities would have had to do would be to go to the proper tomb and point out the body. Much more common, therefore, is the view today that Jesus' corpse simply began to rot. At some point it was taken down, perhaps thrown into a shallow ditch, maybe eaten by dogs or vermin or birds or some combination thereof, mutilated beyond recognition so that there was no way to prove or disprove what happened to the body. The problem with that is that Jewish testimony from ancient Jewish philosophers and rabbis alike highlighted the holiness of the Sabbath, especially during a high holy festival like Passover, where it would have been a disgrace, a shame for a body to be left rotting in this fashion. There are even accounts from the ancient rabbinic sources of members of the Sanhedrin, the high Jewish court, providing tombs for corpses that did not have tombs in order that their land not be desecrated. Another semi-common approach is that the disciples had some kind of subjective visionary experience. Some would use the term mass hallucination. And there have been throughout the history of humanity fascinating accounts of large numbers of people at certain shrines or holy places claiming to see the same supernatural phenomenon, but never apart from an object, a statue, a painting, a shawl, some actual entity that in whatever light or in whatever fashion gives rise to the repeated hallucinations. And yet, nothing of that kind is ever hinted at inside or outside the Bible in the ancient world. That leaves the main alternative to a bodily resurrection. That the stories that we have in the New Testament are some kind of legend or myth. Perhaps modeled on other legends of the ancient Middle East and Mediterranean world. It is argued that there were pre-Christian accounts of gods and goddesses in Greek and Roman and Eastern religions who died and were resurrected. Argued sometimes that such stories existed in abundance. But it's important to look at the dates of these traditions. The ones that are pre-Christian are almost exclusively about gods and or goddesses tied to the cycle of the seasons, just as it appears that the earth dies and plants no longer grow, unless you're here in this beautiful green part of the world. It doesn't happen in Colorado. It gets very brown. And then spring comes and new life appears again. All kinds of mythology from the ancient world talked about gods dying every winter and rising every spring. But that's a far cry from the story of Jesus, a human being who people knew actually lived, claiming to see that he had come back again. A view debunked over a century ago has become popular again, especially in the blog world, of the story of Horus. And if you Google Horus, it doesn't take you very long to find all kinds of sites claiming that he had a virgin birth and death and a resurrection of the body. When you actually consult the sources, however, you discover that Horus was a falcon god, not a human being, that there was no virgin birth, that the myths say he did die, but it was his parents, Isis and Osiris, who died and rose again in that annual cycle. And it was Osiris, after he had been dismembered into multiple pieces, who was somehow reconstituted in the underworld to have relationships with his goddess wife Isis to begin the cycle all over again. Once again, almost nothing in common with the biblical story. What about emperor worship? Augustus, Caligula, Nero, eventually Domitian, and others in between, deified upon their deaths. Yes, sometimes even the Senate declared them as such. But there were no sightings. There were no claims of a bodily resurrection. This was belief in the immortality of the soul. What about the tradition that Nero was going to return? Nero redivivus in the Latin, revived. A time came when there were claims similar to that of a coming resurrection, but the earliest accounts of Nero were simply that he had not died, that he had disappeared and gone to Parthia, the most hostile empire to Rome on the northeast side of it, and was amassing armies to come back and attack someday. Not really the resurrection. You do begin to get stories, especially in an ancient sect called Gnosticism, actually a collection of sects, that do start to resemble more the biblical accounts. The problem is the earliest attestation for all of them is post-Christian, post-first century, So if we are going to speak of any relationship of influence, it would have to be that Christianity influenced these other religious claims rather than vice versa. When we amass all the evidence, when we canvass all the alleged parallels, and expand our horizons for that matter back as far as we can into antiquity and right up to the present, the biblical claims for Jesus are unique. No other founder or important figure of a major world religion known by his followers to have been a human being, to have walked with them, to have taught them, to have begun the ideology that they support, no such founder has ever even been claimed to be resurrected within the lifetime of those who had followed him. That makes the biblical claims unique. But is there positive support to suggest they might be true? Paul, author of 13 letters in the New Testament, describes in 1 Corinthians chapter 15, a letter to the church in Corinth, that he passed on to them what he received as of first importance. That last phrase can also be translated at the first, and it may mean both. And then he proceeds to give a list of key eyewitnesses to the resurrection. In other words, Paul is saying, using technical language in Greek and Hebrew prior to the Greek, for the transmission of oral tradition, that one of the most important things and one of the first things he was taught as a believer was about the bodily resurrection of Jesus. And that he, in turn, shared that when he first came to Corinth and began to plant the church there. These same truths as of first importance at the first. But if you crunch the numbers and do a biblical chronology of dates, Saul of Tarsus, persecutor of the first Christians, radically converted on the Damascus Road, had that experience no more than 2 to 3 years after Jesus' death. So now we're not talking about something in the 50s written after an event in 30. We're talking about testimony that was already widely acknowledged to be fundamental to the emerging Christian faith within a year or two after Jesus' death. The German atheist professor of history, Gerd Ludemann, in a book, What Really Happened at the Resurrection, makes a very cogent argument that we cannot call the rise of the belief in the resurrection a myth, a legend, something that slowly evolved through an evolutionary process, but that it sprang into existence at a remarkably early date, within a year or two, if not even months, after Jesus' death. Ludemann is more candid than many. After saying that, he says, but of course we know a resurrection can't happen. And he opts for the subjective vision hypothesis. But if we don't preclude on what can or cannot happen, if there is a God, another debate for another night, who can act supernaturally in this world, part of a standard definition of God, then Ludemann's argument is extremely solid. Here is a conviction about Jesus' resurrection virtually from the beginning. A second positive line of evidence. How was it that the first followers of Jesus, initially all of them Jewish, began, as we see already on the pages of the New Testament, to violate one of the 10 most sacred commandments of their scriptures? Remember the Sabbath day, Saturday, the seventh day of the week, to keep it holy, and began to worship on Sundays. Who has the right to change one of the Big Ten? And I'm not referring to a sports conference. You would like to see things happen to the Big Ten. But that was not in ancient Jewish form. Thirdly, who, if they were largely inventing a story, would in the admittedly very chauvinistic world of the first century create a story where several women and no men were the first witnesses, with all of the differences in Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John as to what is or isn't included about the resurrection? That's one detail that's in all four accounts. With rare exception, women's testimony was not admitted in a court of law. Would you make up a story this way and be counterproductive to your own cause in the process? It's often pointed out that there are apparent inconsistencies of minor details among the resurrection accounts. Plausible harmonizations have been offered for all of them, but there is a remarkable amount of diversity, more so than in the rest of the gospel tradition, which also suggests that the writers were not in collusion. They were not literally dependent on one another at that point the way they seem to have been in other places. There was multiply attested belief in Jesus' bodily resurrection. Another point is to compare the gospel, the canonical gospel accounts, with the so-called apocryphal gospel literature, and see that the New Testament accounts are actually quite restrained. If you were making up a story, you missed something extremely crucial. How did Jesus get out of the tomb with the disc-like circular heavy stone rolled into place, sealing the tomb? How did he get by the guards? Apocryphal accounts have angels whose heads are as high as the clouds come and assist Jesus. The Gospel of Peter says, whose head went through the clouds. Now that's some good science fiction. Nothing like that in the canonical Gospels. In fact, no attempt to describe what no one was there to see, namely Jesus' departure. Yet again, no tomb ever became a site of pilgrimage or veneration in the earliest centuries. Today, you can go to the Church of the Holy Sepulchre, and that may be the site of Jesus' crucifixion. You can go to Gordon's Calvary and see the outcropping of rocks, not in the right location, but probably very similar to what the landscape looked like in the right location in the first century. You see why Golgotha, the place of the skull, came up with that name. But in the earliest centuries, there was no shrine. There was no place that anyone went to because they didn't believe there was a body there to honor. And how was it that Deuteronomy 21, 23, part of the Jewish law, believed to be sacred, that said, cursed is anyone who hangs on a tree, on a pole, on a wooden cross beam of some kind. How was it that Jews could overcome the fact that the manner of Jesus' death proved by their law that he was accursed by God. The theological answer, at least as Paul articulated, was that he was cursed by God for the sins of humanity and not for his own sins. But if you were making up a story about a death and resurrection, would you make it so difficult for yourself? There was no Jewish expectation of a resurrection prematurely apart from the resurrection of all people at the end of time, as Daniel 12 puts it. There were all kinds of insurrectionists in the first century. All of them eventually put down, some of them horribly massacred by Rome and its troops. And all of them died out or had the leadership passed to a family member. When Jesus was crucified, leadership was not passed to a family member, but the group did not die out. What was different about that experience? And finally, how can we explain the amazing transformation of Jesus' closest followers from hiding behind locked doors after Jesus' execution, understandably for fear that they might be next, to boldly proclaiming a resurrected Jesus in the temple precincts under the shadow of the very religious authorities that had crucified their leader? How do we account for an unbroken growth of the Christian church from the earliest days on, unless something akin to the gospel accounts of the bodily resurrection occurred? Of course, we can follow Professor Ludeman. We can say that modern science knows that such an event is impossible. But modern science, or just science, by definition, is the study of the repeatable, that which can be tested and verified under laboratory conditions. Science, by nature, is not in a position to pontificate on a unique event, whether it's the resurrection or some non-supernatural but unique historical event. For history, we have to turn to eyewitnesses, we have to turn to written records, to oral traditions, and the evidence that we have, going right back to the beginning, in my opinion, makes the case for bodily resurrection of Jesus as a fact of history. My tempted to say lovely assistant, but I don't know whether she'd be offended by that, but she is smiling. She's about to hold up the 1 minute sign, so I'm gonna quit before she has to do even that. And thank you for your attention.
Where he has taught courses in New Testament as Literature, Old Testament as Literature, Paradise Lost, and The Search for God, all from a humanistic point of view. Dr. Stecher has also co-authored a book entitled God Questions, which is the record of the debate that arose out of a correspondence between Dr. Stecher and the English philosopher Peter S. Williams. In addition to this, Dr. Stecher has had articles in Change, The Humanist, and Skeptic, wherein he published his essay, Faith, Facts, and the Resurrection of Jesus. It is a review of N.T. Wright's book, The Resurrection of the Son of God. Dr. Stecher now teaches as part of Salem State's Lifelong Learning Program, an educational program for adults who wish to continue their education without the constraints of a formal college setting. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome Dr. Carl Stecher.
Thank you, Peter. And I'd like to thank the Socratic Club for organizing this debate. I would like to thank specifically Peter and Matthew and Timothy, who picked me up at the airport. I'm half expecting to meet Mark and James, the son of Zebedee, before the evening is over. Judas, however, is not invited. And thank you, Professor Craig Blomberg. We had the pleasure of breaking bread together, and I very much enjoyed his company, and he's already demonstrated that we have a lot to learn from him. But I will be taking issue, of course, otherwise why would we be here? I will be taking issue with the question, the sole question, whether the resurrection, the physical resurrection of Jesus, is beyond a fact, an article of faith, but it is a fact of history. And my contention will be that the historical evidence is just insufficient to make this anything approaching a certainty. I will directly address many of Craig's arguments. I'd like to start, though, with just a little bit about primary and secondary sources. A primary source is defined by the Society of American Archivists as, quote, material that contains firsthand accounts of events that were created contemporaneous to these events or later recalled by eyewitnesses. A secondary source is a work that is not based upon direct observation. Secondary sources rely on primary sources, usually multiple primary sources, to draw conclusions. Now, I think this distinction is crucial in evaluating documents such as the Gospels. Craig, we've agreed to call each other by our first names. Craig makes many points related to the empty tomb. And I will call it the alleged empty tomb, because I want to challenge whether this empty tomb itself is a fact of history. First, does the story of Pilate and Joseph of Arimathea ring true? The Romans crucified thousands of insurrectionists, and the whole point was to inflict the most painful possible death upon the insurrectionist, and then to desecrate his body by letting it rot on the cross, eventually throwing it into a common felon's grave. The message was, this is what happens to those who challenge Roman rule. Jesus had been hailed as the Messiah who was going to overthrow Roman rule and establish the kingdom of God in Jerusalem. He had created a disturbance in the temple. He had been indicted by the temple priests as someone who claimed to be king of the Jews, and he was promptly executed by the Romans for this offense. Now, contrary to the gospel portraits of Pilate, as a rather nice fellow, philosophical, reluctant to harm Jesus, but intimidated by a howling mob of Jews, contemporary historians portrayed Pilate as a bloodthirsty tyrant, a Roman thug, finally removed from office because of his violent excesses. How likely is it that Joseph of Arimathea, or anyone else for that matter, would reveal himself as a sympathizer, hoping to give Jesus a lavish burial, practically volunteering to be the next one crucified? Jesus' disciples had more good sense. When Jesus was arrested, they ran and hid. Even Peter, lurking around to learn his master's fate, denied Jesus three times. One more blow against the empty tomb claim, and interestingly, Craig himself has presented this, and that is that there is no record of this tomb being venerated by first century Christians. I confess, Craig's logic escapes me at this point. Is it really possible that the site of the resurrection, the very foundation of the Christian faith, would not be venerated? Wouldn't there have been an overwhelming impulse to visit this most holy site and say, and here is the great stone that was rolled away, and here is the table upon which the body of our dead Lord was placed before he was resurrected? And this is where the disciples would have taken Jewish skeptics to show them the empty tomb, if there had ever been such an empty tomb. I'm going to ask you to use your imagination. Every day, thousands of people go to the gravesite of John Kennedy in Arlington National Cemetery. Imagine that one day, witnessed by thousands of people, an angel descended from heaven and opened up Kennedy's grave. From the grave arose the body, now again alive, of John Kennedy. He ascends to heaven, first giving a blessing to all who witness this, and disappears into a cloud. Okay, now I want you to imagine this. A year or so later, someone planning a vacation trip to Washington, D.C. Can you imagine such a person saying, "Louisa, I don't see any point in visiting Kennedy's grave. After all, his body isn't there anymore. Let's go to the zoo and see the pandas instead." This just doesn't seem to me the way the human mind works. Even if, as unlikely it seems, there was an empty tomb, might the tomb have been discovered empty without a suicidal Joseph, without a falsified nice guy Pilate, and a miraculous resurrection? I think so. My time is short. I hope that I will get a chance to explain to Professor Blomberg my view of how this could happen without a miraculous resurrection. Let's turn now to Paul's testimony. Now, Paul's testimony is found in 1 Corinthians 15, 3-8. And as Craig has said, this was written about 20 years after Jesus' reported resurrection. It reads, slightly condensed, as follows. Paul's words. "First and foremost, I handed unto you the tradition that I had received, that Christ died for our sins, that he was buried, that he was raised to life on the third day, and that he appeared to Cephas, and afterwards to the 12. Then he appeared to over 500 of our brothers at once, most of whom are still alive, though some have died. Then he appeared to James, and afterwards to all the apostles. And last of all, he appeared to me too." And that's it. Paul says nothing about it too, much less Joseph of Arimathea. Just that Jesus was dead and buried, the second part perhaps only a confirmation of the first, dead and buried. Paul does not identify any first-hand source, but says his information came from, quote, "the tradition I had received." The sentence, "and last of all, he appeared to me too," is a primary source, but only this sentence. The rest of Paul's statement is not even a secondary source, because it is not based upon a primary source. A tradition is not an eyewitness, a primary source. It's a tradition that Santa Claus brings presents to all the world's children on Christmas Eve. And what does Paul actually tell us about the appearances to Jesus, to the disciples, I'm sorry? Remarkably little. When did they see Jesus? Where did they see him? Did he speak to them? What did he say? What did Jesus look like? Were his crucifixion wounds visible? Did he have a fish lunch with them? Was he able to walk through walls? When was the last time they saw him? How did he part from them? Paul tells us nothing. Also significant is the fact that Paul lists himself as the last witness to Jesus' resurrection. He does this without any hint that his encounter with the risen Jesus was any different from the disciples or the 500. And we have Paul's account of his experience on the road to Damascus in his own words, quoted in Acts 22, verses 6-9. Paul, "I was nearing Damascus about midday. A great light suddenly flashed from the sky all around me. I fell to the ground and heard a voice saying, 'Saul, Saul, why do you persecute me? I answered, tell me, Lord, who you are. I am Jesus of Nazareth, he said. My companion saw the light, but did not hear the voice that spoke to me. The event Paul is narrating clearly happened after Jesus' reported ascension. It is not Jesus' resurrected body that Paul is seeing, but only the supposed voice of Jesus who has ascended to God that he is hearing. Paul does not distinguish Jesus' appearance, it's not even an appearance to him, from Jesus' supposed appearance to the others. We have no evidence from Paul that even the tradition he was citing related anything other than visions of the resurrected Jesus, or rather, voices heard by the disciples, for all we know. One other observation. If one of your friends told you he heard a heavenly voice that no one else was able to hear, what would your reaction be? Would you wonder what the guy was smoking? Or think he really should get back on his meds? Paul was a brilliant thinker and a wonderful writer. Many think he invented an entirely new religion. But shouldn't we be a bit cautious about accepting teachings based upon a voice that only Paul could hear? Any diagnosis of mental illness is impossible 2,000 years later. But nevertheless, Paul might have been a cracked pot, a psychoceramic. Let's turn to other points that have been made by Professor, by Craig. We're turning now to the gospel evidence. Several women were the first witnesses. But let's look at exactly how this is reported in the gospels. Did women see Jesus at the empty tomb? According to Matthew, Mary of Magdala and another Mary went to the tomb. Quote, suddenly Jesus was there in their path greeting them. In John's account, Mary of Magdala alone encounters Jesus at the tomb, at first mistaking him for the gardener. He identifies himself and tells her not to cling to him. However, both in Mark's account and Luke's, there is no hint that Mary or any other woman encounters Jesus at the tomb. Even though Luke writes, quote, returning from the tomb, the women reported everything to the 11 and the others. Worth repeating. They reported everything, but they make no mention of the women, of any women seeing Jesus at the tomb. What can be concluded from a close look at the four versions of the same event? Quite clearly, even if there were an empty tomb, Jesus did not appear there. If Jesus had appeared at the tomb, it is inconceivable that that wouldn't be at the heart of every account. An empty tomb is just an empty tomb. Can you imagine the women running to tell the others, we saw an empty tomb, we saw an empty tomb? Big deal. But if they saw Jesus alive and speaking to them after having been dead and buried, that would have been what they were shouting. And yet in both Mark and in Luke, there is no hint that women saw Jesus at the empty tomb. Now, Craig has talked in terms of minor discrepancies. This is not a minor discrepancy. This goes to the very heart of the veracity of the resurrection reports. Did women see Jesus at the empty tomb, or did they not see Jesus at the empty tomb? And what were the women told, either by an angel, or two angels, or Jesus himself, depending upon which version you wish to believe? In Mark, a young man tells the women that Jesus is not there because he has been raised. The angel says, go and say to his disciples and Peter, he is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him as he told you. The women run away terrified and they say nothing to anyone, according to Mark. Period. End of the story. In Matthew, the angel tells the women, quote, he has been raised from the dead and is going ahead of you into Galilee. There you will see him. When the women then encounter Jesus, he repeats the same message. Go and take word to my brothers that they are to leave for Galilee. They will see me there. The women clearly convey this message because in the next passage, Then the 11 disciples made their way to Galilee, to the mountain where Jesus had told them to meet him. In Matthew, this is the only postmortem meeting between Jesus and his disciples. And it is there that he instructs them to make disciples in all nations and departs from them. But in Luke's account, in which, remember, the two women reported everything to the 11 and all the others, the two men in dazzling garments, presumably angels, who speak to the women, make no mention of Galilee, which is at least 90 miles away, an arduous three-day journey. Instead, within 24 hours, Jesus appears, the women discover the empty tomb, and within 24 hours, Jesus appears to two disciples on the nearby road to Emmaus, to the 11 and others in Jerusalem, sharing a fish lunch, then, immediately afterwards, ascends into heaven after instructing them to stay in Jerusalem. Nowhere even a hint that they are to go to Galilee to see him, as Mark and Matthew insisted. So these are major contradictions. Two Gospels say that all the appearances happened in Galilee. Two of them say that they happened in or near Jerusalem. Either the women did see them in one place, did see Jesus, or did not. Either all the appearances were in Galilee, or they were in Jerusalem. But both can't be true. So how can we choose? I don't see any possibility of sorting out which is the truth and which is not the truth. But it calls into question the reliability of all four accounts in the Gospels. Now there's another problem. Craig has suggested that the Gospels are pretty straight on. You don't have much legend in terms of the Gospels. But I don't see this as being true. The nativity accounts that you find in Matthew and Luke are in clear contradiction to each other. And Raymond Brown, the Catholic scholar who writes a massive study of the New Testament and particularly of the birth of the Messiah, finds at least 14 contradictions between the nativity accounts in Matthew and the one in Luke. Fast forward to the death narratives. Mark writes, "Then Jesus gave a loud cry and died, and the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom." Matthew and Luke repeat this story almost verbatim. Jewish records say this curtain separated the Holy of Holies from the rest of the temple, was 30 feet high and 4 inches thick. It would have taken a miracle for this curtain to be torn. But there is nowhere any record of this event in Jewish sources, not even a faint suggestion that this ever happened. Only the Gospels record it, and they don't tell us upon what witness. Clearly, this is a legend. But the most significant legend is found only in Matthew. I think of this as Matthew's zombie story. Right after the temple curtain is torn, Matthew writes, "The earth shook, rocks split, and graves opened. Many of God's saints were raised from sleep, and coming out of their graves, entered the holy city where many saw them." Strangely, only Matthew notices this astonishing event. There's not a hint of it in the other Gospels, nor in any Jewish or Roman account. And Matthew doesn't tell us whether these living dead were clothed or naked, whether they returned to their homes and families and how they were received there, or whether they just paraded around Jerusalem for a while and then went back to their graves and reburied themselves. Now, this strikes me as a preposterous legend. But how do we distinguish the legendary from the historical? It's partly legend, presumably partly historical. But where is the line, and how can we know which side of the line the resurrection stories fall? Another problem with the accounts, the resurrection accounts in the Gospels. There are clearly fictional elements. Episodes and conversations are related for which there could have been no actual source. For example, Matthew 27, 3-8. "When Judas the traitor saw that Jesus had been condemned, he was seized with remorse. Sinned. I have brought an innocent man to his death." But the priest said, "What is that to us? It is your concern." So Judas threw the money down in the temple and went away and hanged himself. The chief priests took up the money, but they said, "This cannot be put into the temple fund, it is blood money." So who is the witness that reported these words to the author of Matthew? Not Judas, he's hanged himself. And I can't imagine one of the priests saying to the author of Matthew, "We thought you'd like to know what passed between us and Judas." The same is true for the varying reports of the trial of Jesus. In John 18 through John 19, and this is greatly condensed, Jesus was led into the governor's headquarters. The Jews themselves stayed outside the headquarters to avoid defilement so that they could eat the Passover meal. Pilate then went back into the headquarters where he interviews Jesus. The Jews who could have been witnesses are left in the courtyard. There's a private conversation between Pilate and Jesus, and yet it is reported verbatim, word for word. What's the source for this? Who witnessed this and would have reported it to the author? The obvious answer is that this is a fiction. The gospel writers just made stuff up. And that leaves the problem, where is the line between the fictional parts and the historical parts? How can we be sure which side of the line the tales of the resurrection fall? Well, then there's the question of how the resurrection stories might have begun. Is it possible that the stories could have originated without actual physical appearances? How much time do I have, please?
About three.
Great. Well, let's begin with grief hallucinations. According to an article in 2008 in Scientific America, the dead stay with us, that much is clear. They remain in our hearts and minds, and of course, but for many people, they also linger in our senses as sights, sounds, smells, touches, or presences. Grief hallucinations are a normal reaction to bereavement and are rarely discussed because people fear that they might be considered insane or mentally destabilized by their loss. But we now know that they are common. Now, let's start then with some grief hallucinations, and then some statements which might plausibly have been made by his disciples in the months or years after his death. A disciple. "I was in the market the other day and I saw Jesus. I called to him, but the Roman legionaries marched between us, and when they were gone, he was no longer there." This could be mistaken identity. Eyeglasses weren't invented until centuries later. Another disciple. "I couldn't sleep for nights after Jesus was killed by the Romans. I just could not believe he was really dead. And then late one night, I saw him. You were there, Peter, and you, James. All of us were there in a room somewhere. And then suddenly, Jesus was there too. He seemed to walk right through the wall. And he ate some fish and talked to us, but then he was gone. A dream." Another disciple. "It's terrible, almost as bad as his horrible death, that he did not have an honorable burial, at least. I just can't believe it." Another disciple. "There was one member of the Sanhedrin who I saw several times there when Jesus was teaching us. I could see he was coming to believe. I think his name was Joseph of Appleton or Arlington or Arimathea, some such place." Another disciple. "Someone could have buried Jesus secretly, someone in his family perhaps, and we wouldn't know about it because we were all in hiding that day. And no one would confess to it because of the danger. Mary saw Jesus die and told me there were several empty tombs in the area. Maybe somebody was able to bury him in one of those rather than have him tossed in a common grave with criminals." That's wishful thinking. Another. "I remember the time in Galilee at the foot of a mountain when he told us when he died, he wanted us to carry on his teachings." Last disciple. "He is not dead. He will always be alive as long as we remember and teach others what he taught us, that the love of God is eternal and extended to all." So take these brief hallucinations, add in seven statements very plausibly made by his disciples, blend in a few angelic announcements and legends, shake well for several years, have them retold and retold and retold, and 35 to 70 years later, the four gospel accounts of the appearances. This suggested paradigm has several advantages over the claimed historic proofs of Jesus' physical resurrection. First, it avoids the problems presented by the major contradictions in the gospel accounts. Such contradictions would be expected if the stories developed as I have suggested. Second, this version does not portray weird human behavior. An empty tomb, the supposed site of this stupendous miracle, but a site not venerated or even kept track of. Women seeing Jesus at the tomb, telling the disciples of everything, but this story may not be part of it. Thank you for it, and my time is up. And just the last point, this version does not require the intervention of a God and a stupendous miracle. Thank you.
Discussion in general. Speakers, please limit your answers to 1 or 2 minutes as our time is limited. Also, I would like to remind the audience to remain respectful of our speakers by not applauding until the end of the discussion. Dr. Blomberg, do you have a question for Dr. Stecher?
Sure. Why don't we start at the end with the potential sayings that different disciples had in the brief. I gather they, on your hypothesis, happen here, there, and everywhere, and different times and places. So how did the change of worship to a Sunday begin? Doesn't that require something rather stupendous to have happened on a Sunday?
Well, I wonder about that. Now, as I read the Gospels, the disciples in Jerusalem continued to go to the temple and to the synagogue, presumably on Saturday. And in fact, I think it says in one place that they went every day. Now, when exactly did they abandon going to the temple on the Sabbath and instead exclusively go on Sunday rather than Saturday?
Right. It was a gradual process, obviously. You have three different references in Acts, 1 Corinthians, and Revelation to that. And then even into the second century, you have not just Gentile, but Jewish people who are worshiping on the Sunday. So I'm not saying that there was a newspaper clipping on April 8th, AD 30, that said, forget the temple on Saturday, start going on Sunday.
Mm-hmm.
But why would Jews even gradually begin to make that shift? Why shift at all, at any point? They had an immutable command from God, as they believed it was, out of Exodus.
Well, that's a good question. What is the origin of the Christian belief? And I would have to say that certainly the belief that Jesus had been resurrected, a redefinition of the Messiah, the original expectation, the Jewish expectation for a Messiah, as you know, was not somebody who was going to be executed by the Romans, but he was somebody who was going to help establish the kingdom of God, be the main figure in the kingdom of God that was going to be established here on earth. Now, Bart Ehrman argues that when that expectation was disappointed, the disciples started searching in the Old Testament for a reinterpretation of the Messiah, This is what they ended up with. But it seemed to have been a very gradual process, and as I understand it, it happened much more slowly, perhaps, in Jerusalem than it happened in other communities where there were Jews and Gentiles worshiping together even before Jesus' death and purported resurrection. And there was considerable Greek influence in these temples and synagogues, not the temple, but the synagogues, in places like Thessalonica and Philippi and wherever.
I just don't see any of that explaining the Sunday piece, but it's your turn to ask me something.
Sure. Now, let's see here. Since I confessed my own religious orientation, I'd like to request that you do the same, and specifically, do you believe the Old and New Testaments are the inspired word of God, inerrant in the original writings, and that they are the supreme and final authority in all matters to which they speak?
I think I've read that somewhere.
Yes, that does sound familiar, doesn't it?
As a religious person, as a confession of faith, yes, I would affirm those. As a historian, I would have more modest goals, and that would be not necessarily to claim that on historical grounds alone we can corroborate every detail, every story in Scripture. The further back you go in history, the less exists of potential evidence to corroborate or to disconfirm something. So a belief statement about Scripture, had the debate tonight been, is a belief in an inerrant Scripture a statement of faith, I would have said, sure, it is. But I do believe that there are central pieces to the Bible storyline. The closer you get to the New Testament, the more evidence there is. When you get to the New Testament, then the evidence becomes massive enough to write entire books just on the archaeology of the New Testament. I do think you can speak of things that are more than just tenets of faith, but are actual historical facts.
Mm-hmm. Now, I perhaps should put this in a context that I didn't originally establish, and that is in the context of confirmation bias. And confirmation bias is a term that psychologists use. It's a tendency, a universal human tendency, that if you have a firm conviction, you seek out and you tend to believe evidence that supports that conviction, and on the other hand, you tend to be dismissive and skeptical about evidence that doesn't confirm your conviction. Now, applying this to some of the examples that I use of legends in the resurrection accounts, and specifically, the resurrection of many saints at the death of Jesus, and they're walking around Jerusalem and being seen by many people. Now, do you view that as a fact of history, or is that, in your view, legend?
It's a fascinating question. A man by the name of Michael Kona, who wrote a huge book recently defending the resurrection, argues on literary grounds, comparing those kinds of details to what do appear to be what he calls apocalyptic symbols. I don't think he would say they're legend in the sense of something put forward as the activity of gods or goddesses, but not actually occurring on earth, but couched in a way to suggest that Jesus' resurrection, as Paul himself says in 1 Corinthians 15, was the first fruits of the coming resurrection of all people. If you had to pick one story in the entire New Testament where I think on the basis of literary genre you could make a case for something being more symbolic than literal, that might well be it. But I don't think that calls into question the entire story, if for no other reason than, as you pointed out, it's only in Matthew. It's not an integral part of the story, as everybody tells it. Is it my turn?
Yes.
So I want to talk about Joseph of Arimathea.
Mm-hmm. William Lane Craig, I think, slightly overstates himself when he says that story is the most indisputable and factual part of the whole gospel record. But I still think he has a point there. If Jesus had anything remotely like the impact the gospels give us the impression he had, it seems inconceivable that at least a few of the Sanhedrin, the Jewish authorities, wouldn't have come to at least secretly start to admire him. And with the evidence I alluded to of the great importance of not desecrating the land, especially on the Sabbath, isn't it rather likely that a wealthy person, a prominent member of the Sanhedrin, might dare to ask Pilate, who, yes, he was ruthless, but he was also sent to Israel. That was no honor for a Roman commander. And you were caught in between a rock and a hard place. These Jews were noted, one could hear the emperor saying, for rebellion, for riots, for insurrectionists. You've got to keep the peace, but you can't do it at all costs. You have to find ways to placate the real power brokers within Israel so that you're not fighting these terrorists every day and every night. To me, the story of Joseph Arimathea is one of the most credible ones, because no other later New Testament writer makes anything of it. He's not a character that reappears, and yet every one of the four Gospels, despite all the diversity you talked about, says Joseph took the body and buried it.
Right, well, aren't they all probably based upon Mark? I mean, this is pretty much a scholarly consensus for the last 50 years that not John, but certainly Matthew and Luke, use Mark as their source. So it's not really independent attestation. It's and John, by the time John writes, he must know something about the other three Gospels. We can't assume that he knows nothing. So really, I think...
Well, go with Mark.
Well, just Mark, right? Well, then you only have one person
isn't
telling the story.
Isn't it an incredible story, though?
Yes, exactly. It's incredible. It's
isn't it an incredible story?
Oh, I'm
sorry.
I heard incredible. My response would be no, it's an incredible story, given the danger that Joseph would have been placing himself in. Now, if he was interested in honoring the body of Jesus, it would have made much more sense for him to approach the soldiers at the cross and here's $50. Nobody will know. We'll come at night. You can let us have the body, and he could put it in one tomb. The next night, perhaps, the soldiers come back and they want to destroy the evidence of their own corruption, and so they toss it in the common grave. Sunday morning, the women come. There's the empty tomb, and there's no miracle here. And there's no reason that this isn't, that I can think of, that this isn't a plausible explanation of what might have happened.
So a lowly soldier would be willing to risk Pilate's ire, but a wealthy, powerful Jew wouldn't be.
I think a $50, you know, right? And we can do this in secret. Yeah, it seems to me more likely.
Your turn.
Okay, the Ascension. Now, the Ascension is something that there's some disagreement about, even conservative biblical scholars. And I'm wondering, let's see, this is the account that we have. And this is I get my full version here. Here it is, I'm sorry. Acts 1, verses 9-11. He was seen by them over a period of 40 days. Jesus was lifted up before their very eyes, and a cloud took him from their sight. They were gazing intently into the sky as he went, and all at once there stood beside them two men robed in white who said, "Men of Galilee, Why stand there looking up into the sky? This Jesus who has been taken from you up to heaven will come in the same way as you've seen him go. Now, N.T. Wright says that this is not to be taken literally. Not a triple-decker or a double-decker universe, but instead that this is somehow or other metaphorical. I'm wondering what your interpretation of this is. Did Jesus literally go up into the sky in the sight of his disciples and disappear into a cloud?
Well, it's an interesting question. And what's striking to me is how little Luke actually claims for what happened. If he was creating something mythological, what you just described is probably what he would have said. It says he was taken up, up erthe. The verb can mean lifted up. It can mean taken away. It doesn't have to have a spatial side to it. And a cloud hid him. Where? On the ground? In the sky? They're looking up into the sky as he was going. What did that look like? The restraint in the narration is what strikes me. We can try to fill in the details. You talked about the potential bias that any believer has in seeking for confirmation too quickly. Might the typical atheist have the bias to read these stories and read a lot more details in than are actually told to us? Even to some of the tone of voice you use to humorously retell things in your talk, kind of skew things a little bit toward your side. In a world that believed heaven was up, it made sense for something to happen that led the disciples to think Jesus went to heaven. If he had gone down, that would have communicated the wrong idea altogether.
I understand.
If he were in our world, would it look like a transporter room? I don't know. Dematerializing. But Wright does not deny the ascension. He simply says, yeah, we can't tell very many details if we just stick to the account that's there. But weren't we talking about the resurrection?
Yes, we're talking about the resurrection, but we're also talking about our understanding of legend and understanding of the way things actually are. What happens in history?
Right.
And now it seems to me, again, as I read this, this sounds like a historic account of an event as it is witnessed in the first century. And it reads, he was seen by them over a period of 40 days. He was lifted up before their very eyes, and a cloud took him from their sight. They were gazing intently into the sky as he went. And that sounds to me as matter of fact as any account of the resurrection experiences.
Yeah.
Now, if what was being described here was not historical, but was instead some other way of describing an event that couldn't be described, well, how can we be sure that the accounts of the resurrection don't fall into the same category?
No, I would want to affirm that the way you phrased it just now, which limited to the scriptural text, that is what happened. And interestingly, you had asked the question, how would the disciples have known about a private conversation between Jesus and Pilate, or anything else for that matter that Jesus did when there weren't any witnesses, if there is anything to the claim that he appeared over a period of 40 days and gave many proofs that he was alive and spoke about the kingdom of God. And the end of Luke's gospel, it says that he showed them how everything in the law and the prophets and the psalms that spoke of him had to be fulfilled. That was one great Old Testament survey course.
over 40 days and an opportunity to divulge to the disciples a lot that they couldn't have been privy to in any other fashion.
Right, well, you've mentioned a fact that is rather confusing to me. Now, there's a universal agreement that the author of Luke and the author of Acts is the same person, the same anonymous, essentially anonymous person. Now, the fact of the matter is, as I look at it, that in Luke, it's quite clear that all the appearances happen within 24 hours, and then Jesus is described as departing from them. While in Acts, there's somehow that the same author extends it to 40 days. Now, here is another discrepancy which calls into question the historical reliability of an author that can't even agree with himself about what actually happened and how long it took to happen.
Well, I think you are, again, reading some things into the text that aren't actually there. Not a single gospel claims to give a comprehensive list of all of Jesus' appearances. No gospel ever said Jesus only appeared in Galilee. No gospel ever said Jesus only appeared in Jerusalem. And John's gospel has appearances in both places, as if he recognizes the simplest solution is that Jesus appeared in Jerusalem while the disciples were still there. He appeared a week later. Why were they still there a week later? Because the Passover feast lasted for a week. And what did Galileans do after Passover was done? They went back home to Galilee. So the most natural thing in the world would be for him to appear there as well. Mark doesn't have a single appearance, but Mark ends abruptly. The women fled from the tomb, saying nothing to anyone because they were afraid. Is that where the gospel originally ended? It might be, because Mark's gospel most emphasizes the fear and failure of the disciples, written probably in the 60s to Roman Christians who were experiencing persecution and feeling very much like failures and frightful, to encourage them that the disciples had been there too. But Mark was not written as an evangelistic tract to people who had never heard the gospel story. They already knew the resurrection, so he stops abruptly to make a different point. Sorry about that.
Speakers will now take questions from the audience. We have 35 minutes total for the Q&A, and that time does tend to pass by very quickly. When I give the word, please form two lines, one in each aisle, and we will alternate taking questions from the two. Please have your question ready when you get in line, and when it is your turn to ask a question, please begin by designating which speaker or speakers your question is for. Keep your question short and to the point. Please refrain from giving a statement of personal opinion, arguing with either of our speakers, or delivering a speech of any kind. Also, please return to your seat right after asking your question, as we don't have time for rebuttals or follow-up questions. And you may now begin lining up. Speakers, if an audience member asks a question of one speaker in particular, I will allow that speaker to answer first, and there the other speaker can comment as well if desired. Please be aware, though, that lengthy answers to each and every question will limit the number of questions we can accept from the people. So please use your speaking time wisely. In general, lengthy answers can limit the number of And if I could please have the first question.
You mentioned the cowardice of the disciples, they're being cowards.
Well, I would have been right with them.
Okay, so you mentioned that they're cowards, based on the testimony of the Gospels, and that Peter negated Christ three times, to demonstrate the character of these guys. And then when it comes to the testimony of the women, which is in the same writings, you question it. So my question to you, you question the validity of these women's testimony, or at least of the writing. So my question to you is, what changes between taking the testimony in the scriptures of the coward disciples, but then you negate the testimony of the women?
No, I think you misunderstand me. In the first place, I'm not calling the disciples cowards. I think they did the thing that any normal person would do. Who wants to be crucified, after all? And in terms of the women, I'm not questioning their veracity. I'm questioning the fact that two of the Gospels report them as saying the women saw Jesus at the tomb, and two of the Gospels make no mention of the women seeing Jesus at the tomb. And this is the question. Now, this is not a minor difference. This is a major contradiction. Mark makes it very clear. The women did not see Jesus at the tomb. Luke makes it very clear that the women did not see Jesus at the tomb, while the other two Gospels say they did. You can't have it both ways. So two of the Gospels are clearly wrong.
That wasn't my question.
No, but I don't think, I'm not sure I understood your question.
My question is, you took the testimony in the scriptures of these cowards, and you took that as truth. But then when you take the same writings of the women testifying, you say that it's not true. Because some of the women saw Jesus in the scriptures also. Mary Magdalene saw Jesus.
According to two of the Gospels, but not according to the other two Gospels.
So one is valid, one isn't.
Well, either two Gospels are right and the other two are wrong, or the other two are wrong and the other two are right.
Or Mark stops before the point at which Matthew describes them seeing him, and John reports a separate incident, because he says Mary went back to the tomb and then saw the gardener, and therefore, since no gospel ever says no one saw him at the tomb, the absence of evidence is not the evidence of absence.
Gentlemen, good evening, and thank you for joining us here in Corvallis. It's a great treat to have a fellow Aberdeen alumnus. And sir, I was a three-year executive member of the Socratic Club. I was here at the first debate that the Socratic Club held at Oregon State. You are by far the best dissenting speaker that I think the club has ever had. So thank you very much, both of you, for joining us.
Thank you.
Now on to my controversial question. I'm very fond of quoting Ecclesiastes, which of course says there's nothing new under the sun. And I look at that as a biblical confirmation that although we perceive change in the world, that really things do tend to stay very consistent as far as, you know, things work in the world. And so on that note, I beg the dear Lord above for forgiveness, because I'm about to compare John Kennedy with Julius Caesar, and I'm about to compare Christ with Osama bin Laden.
Is this a question?
It is, I swear. I would make the point that there's based on your remarks, sir, there's a difference in how graves are treated by contemporaries. In the case of Caesar and Kennedy, we can still go to Caesar's, where some of these ancient figures who were, you know, great political figures, we can still go to where they died, where they were. I have personally been to where Caesar was cremated, in the same way that you gave the example of John Kennedy's, you know, the eternal flame and what have you. By contrast, enemies of the state, it's not quite so straightforward to build up a a sort of shrine. In Christ's day, you couldn't just have a bunch of disciples that, you know, here's the rock that they rolled away, here's the table, because they were a persecuted minority. That's a fact of history. I think you would see the same thing in Pakistan, where people don't just go and visit Osama bin Laden's, you know, place of death, because, you know, the Pakistani government, you know, keeps tabs of that sort of thing, and people don't want to be identified as being, you know, associated with that. So, having established all that, I wonder if the two of you could sort of comment on that. I guess it's not a straightforward question, but your remarks kind of brought that question to my mind, so I wanted to share it and hear your thoughts. Thank you.
Sure. Well, I think I see your point, and you might be right. The disciples might not have been wildly enthusiastic about saying, here is where the miracle happened, but it's impossible for me to imagine that they wouldn't nevertheless at least privately venerate this tomb as the most holy site on earth, the site where the foundation miracle of the faith happened. I just can't imagine how they wouldn't keep this place as a very, very special place, like no other place on earth. And why it would need rediscovery centuries later, because they couldn't even remember where it was. It was so neglected. That just doesn't make any sense to me.
Well, you do have to factor in AD 70 when Rome comes in and destroys Jerusalem and takes the handful of leading people that they didn't kill into exile, leaving only a small group of peasant farmers. So there's not many people left, and certainly not many Christians. Christians by that time are dispersed around the empire as well. So I think that's the biggest reason you don't have a tomb there at a later point. But my reaction to the question, which finally came, was I think it's a good comparison.
if I could just add, but the destruction of Rome did not happen until 40 years later. And the point you made yourself was there's no record of the first generation of Christians venerating the tomb. And
if the most spectacular thing that happened to me spiritually happened in a personal encounter with the risen Jesus in several places, not at the tomb, if I was going to venerate anything, I would have thought it would have been those places. But the whole point was that the mission of Jesus, of the kingdom of God, was to go, tell, spread the word. Don't hang around worshiping a place.
I've got a question for Carl. So you were talking about Luke's and Acts and how they have the same author and he can't get his timeline correct. I guess my question is, during the canonization process, the writings were confirmed, which were widely accepted and circulated among the church. Mm-hmm. So
this is centuries later.
Yes, but while it's easy to argue that one man may overlook a skewed timeline, are you trying to argue that none of the early Christians noticed this skewed timeline if it is actually in the Bible, or do you think you kind of maybe put something in there that wasn't necessarily there?
I can't account for it. I've read scholars who have suggested that he consciously adjusted the date of the ascension to allow for more appearances. And by the way, if I could just comment, given the opportunity here, the account that you have in John of the resurrection does take the disciples back to Galilee, but on the shore, and it says nothing about meeting Jesus at the foot of a mountain, and it seems to be another episode altogether.
I agree. Okay, so you would agree that the early Christian church didn't notice this messed up?
I have no idea what they noticed or the basis for upon which they made the decision to include both.
You can actually find quite a few discussions in the patristic writers, sometimes called the early church fathers, 2nd, 3rd, 4th centuries. By the time you get to Augustine, you have him writing a commentary on harmony of the Gospels. The discrepancies among parallels have been known since the biblical books were first gathered together. And throughout most of church history, people believed that there were plausible harmonizations of them. So it's not as if modern scholars have discovered something new in the Bible that nobody noticed in previous centuries. They just tend to acquire a greater level of precision, a form of reporting akin to what we expect people today to, which is probably highly anachronistic by the standards of ancient historians and biographers. If a writer says one and only one thing happened, and someone else says two of them happened, then you have a contradiction. But to have several different resurrection appearances at different times and places in different Gospels, and no one even making a claim to be giving an exhaustive account, that's not a contradiction.
So this is a question that kind of comes off of what Dr. Blomberg ended in there. And the question is, how might the audience the Gospels were written to affect what is written and possibly included in each of the resurrection accounts in the Gospels?
Are you addressing that to one of us?
First to you.
Okay.
it's
extremely significant, as is what the Gospel writers include or don't include throughout their accounts. I already mentioned a very common explanation of the abrupt ending of Mark. Luke, who also wrote Acts, can be seen to have an hourglass type of structure, where the book of Acts starts with the disciples in Jerusalem. Acts 1:8 is a sort of programmatic statement for the outline of the book, then expanding outward into Judea and Samaria and eventually to the uttermost parts of the earth, which in the first century had its capital in Rome. And that's where the book ends. You can take Luke and see it going from the only gospel writer who puts the events in the context of world history, coming through Galilee, then to Samaria, then to Judea. And yes, it's significant that Luke has only resurrection appearances in and around Jerusalem. Not because he doesn't believe there were others, but because Jerusalem is the center of the hourglass. It's the pivot for what he's trying to do. So when you understand what the gospel writer's trying to do, then their selectivity makes more sense. Matthew has a different appearance in Galilee than John has. There's no doubt about it. The Great Commission, his whole narrative has been showing how what began as a uniquely Jewish sect was to have worldwide ramifications, and he was the one who began uniquely. Only Matthew has the prophecy of Jesus as Emmanuel, God with us. And what does he end with? And Jesus says, "Lo, I am with you even to the end of the world." That's all very deliberately chosen.
I guess mine would be primarily for Dr. Stecher, but I'm going to comment. You mentioned this being a historical account of the bodily resurrection, primary and secondary sources,
mm-hmm.
but you also alluded to legend. So I'm a little fuzzy on the terminology there. You compared it to Santa delivering presents in one night, being legend, but we're not having like a debate about that.
No, we're not debating that.
Right. So could you speak to maybe more evidence for supporting something? Because I'm just confused why like Christopher Columbus would not be a legend, but this would be.
Well, I identified three things really. Legends in the birth narratives, which are, I didn't have the time to get into the details about that, but turning to the torn veil of the temple, that strikes me as being a legend because it would require a stupendous force, a miraculous force, and there's no confirmation that this ever happened despite the exceeding importance that this would have to the Jews who were in the temple. I mean, why didn't they ever notice that the veil was torn at the exact minute that Jesus died? See, that has all the earmarks of a legend. And then I talked about the specific legend of the saints coming out of their tombs with an earthquake. That's, for some reason or other, nobody else notices but Matthew. And the fact that, one, it's so extraordinarily unlikely. And two, that no other source mentions this, and how could they fail to mention it if it actually happened? This identifies these two occurrences as being legendary. So then the question is, well, how do we know that the resurrection appearances weren't legends too? Once we've established the fact that there are legends attached even to the death of Jesus, how do we know that these don't extend to the resurrection appearances?
It's interesting to ask the question of other Jewish testimony. Who knows what sources have been lost? There is, to our knowledge, only one Jewish historian who wrote in the first century whose works have survived, Josephus. And he does mention an earthquake prior to the destruction of the temple, and he does not date it. There were multiple earthquakes throughout the Middle East in the period between 30 and 70. And I think a strong earthquake would have been enough to rip the veil and not have anything supernatural there at all. Interestingly, Josephus does refer to several portents that he says occurred 40 years before the destruction of the temple. That would be exactly the year Jesus died. Now, it'd be wonderful if one of those was the ripping of the veil. He doesn't say that. But he talks about lights going out. He talks about doors swinging open that are locked. Is this legend? Is this the legendary vestige of the recognition of some very strange, stupendous event at that time? It's very hard to know. But when you start asking, why isn't this recorded elsewhere? There's only one existing source where it could have been, and something strange is going on in it.
One existing source for what?
For a Jewish historian writing in the first century.
About what?
The events of Israel.
Are you talking specifically about the curtain, or are you talking about the resurrection?
I'm talking about something happening in and around the temple, unprecedented in significance, with strange signs accompanying it in the year 30 AD.
How about the saints coming out of their graves and burying around Jerusalem? Now that's
well, we already talked about that.
Yes, we did, but I'm wondering, you know, I'm not quite clear on what you're saying here in relation to that.
We should move on. It would be nice to get to this.
Sure.
Thank you.
Sorry.
Yeah, so this question is on earlier you had mentioned, it's Carl, right?
Yes.
That Paul speaks in 1 Corinthians 15, it says, I delivered to you first of all that which I also received. And I believe you seem to believe that it was something I'd been passed on to him. Is that correct?
It's out of context. I'm not quite sure what Paul is saying, because at times he talks about everything that he learned directly from the Lord.
That was my question for you.
Yeah.
Because at the time that you were speaking, the way you phrased it was to make you believe that he received it from other men and that he was passing it on. But Paul himself, after writing this, or actually prior to writing this, he writes in Galatians that he did not receive it from man.
Right.
But he received it directly from the Lord by revelation.
Right.
So how do you reconcile those two in the way that you presented it? That's my question.
Well, I'm wondering how Paul reconciles it. Did he receive this information from men, or did he receive it in a vision from Jesus? And I'm not quite clear on what he's saying or whether he's being consistent here. You're right. There are passages in which he says everything that I know from the Lord. And he includes in this a prediction about the second coming, that some people who are living now will still be alive when Jesus returns in the second coming. And he says he received this directly from the Lord. This isn't something that he learned from men. And so this, if anything, weakens Paul as a source for history, because, well, quite clearly, the second coming did not happen while the generation of which he was a part was still alive.
Once again, we have to come back to what the Bible actually says, which also corrects the question. Carl did quote 1 Corinthians 15 accurately, which does say that Paul passed on what he received. And that is the language for what you learn from other human beings. But Galatians does not say, everything I learned from God. Galatians 1:11 says, I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ. The moment he saw the risen Christ on the Damascus Road, he didn't need anyone to teach him that Jesus was the Messiah and not an archapostate, that he was divine, that he had been raised from the dead prematurely from Jewish expectation before the general resurrection of anyone, and that therefore he was the one he ought to be serving rather than fighting against, the heart of the gospel. It never says that Jesus revealed to him who were all the witnesses to his resurrection. That had to have been passed on, humanly speaking, and that's what 1 Corinthians 15 is talking about. So there's no contradiction there. We've got to read what the Bible actually says and not paraphrase it in ways that conveniently make it contradictory when it wasn't originally.
Hello. My question is, in 1 Corinthians 14:33, it says, God is not the author of confusion, as I'm sure you all know. In that case, why are the accounts of Jesus' resurrection and Judas' death and several, at least in the dissenters' point of view, several other contradictions, why are they present in the Bible if the God was, or if God created or inspired the Bible and did not want it to be confusing? Because I find it quite confusing.
I think the biggest short answer to that question, which I could talk on at length until Peter were to shut me up again, is to say that we live 2,000 years and half a world away. In the original context, by the standards of Greco-Roman biography and history, the vast majority of the things that we tend today to call discrepancies would not have been viewed as such. You've probably had conversations with friends that weren't confusing. But if they were to be retold 2,000 years from now in Mali or Mauritania, they might get confused.
Dr. Stecher, did you have any comments?
No.
I was actually, I don't know if anybody else is thinking this question, but it's pretty much all I can think about. I was just curious why, for both of you, why would you debate the resurrection of Christ, or Jesus? Why does it matter so much to you, both of you, to study for it sounds like most of your lives, that one thing?
Okay. I'll take that. Well, for me, I read N.T. Wright's book, The Resurrection of the Son of God, all 800-some pages of it. And I come from an interest in history, and I wasn't satisfied with his conclusions. I didn't think he made the case, and I thought there were gigantic holes in his argument. And so, for me, this has been a consuming interest. Religious belief and why people believe or disbelieve. I fall on that side. And so for me, this was a challenge, and I wrote a response to N.T. Wright's book in a much shorter format. believe me. And so for me, this is just one of my chief intellectual interests in life. And at the very core of the question of religious belief, if you're coming from a Christian background, is this belief in the physical resurrection of Jesus. So that's my response. Greg?
I was raised in the old Lutheran Church of America that's now part of the ELCA, and in that turbulent year, 1968, was confirmed. Some of you studied it in your history books. And I can still remember my young pastor in our confirmation class turning to a passage. It wasn't the resurrection, but it was part of the events that led right up to it, and pointing out similar discrepancies, differences, apparent contradictions, whatever you want to call them, in parallel accounts, and I'm not quite sure how this was supposed to help our faith, but I guess to try to get us to see, even as kids, what the Bible really was. And I began to look at this and say, these aren't contradictions. You're reading things in, you're making assumptions that the text doesn't actually say. And he had no answer for me. And in those years, confirmation was the ticket to leave church. You put in your time, so I left. But then in high school, I was introduced to through a campus life club. For the first time, peers of mine for whom faith was a very genuine reality. And sadly, I don't think I'd seen that among my age group at my church. And they didn't shy away from the hard topics of the faith. And the same was true for college ministry I was a part of. I did not come to the Bible presupposing that it was inspired and inerrant. To quote the statement of faith that Carl read earlier, I came from a background of suspicion, but I was suspicious of the suspicion. And I began to find all kinds of credible answers and plausible resolutions to these apparent problems, and little by little moved away from that liberalism of my upbringing and came to believe that there were very good, solid reasons for the reliability of the Gospels. I've written two books, have another one coming out next month on Can We Believe the Bible in the 21st Century? And I find over and over again that the answer is yes. And Carl's right, the resurrection is at the heart of those claims, so you have to talk about it.
We have time for one more question.
Lucky me. Good evening, gentlemen. Thank you for the debate so far. My question is to Dr. Craig. In what way does the change of the Sabbath from Saturday to Sunday have anything to do with the suspension of the laws of nature? So far, the evidence for that suspension just seems a little shaky. I'm not sure if that transition has anything to do with it.
It has absolutely nothing to do with it. If your question... If a reason for being skeptical of the resurrection is that you just don't believe a resurrection can happen, then nothing that I said tonight will change your mind. If you are at least open to the possibility of there being a transcendent God, creator of the universe, who in his sovereign time, and when he chooses, occasionally works through different fashions than he normally does through the scientific laws of the universe, then that doesn't prove the resurrection either. That just leaves the door open that could have happened. But there are all kinds of crazy claims. Call them legends, call them myths if you like. So now I have to then give evidence for why this one might actually be credible when I don't accept everyone that comes down the pike. And if I get to that part, of the argument. Then the question, what would make a group of Jewish followers of a self-styled Jewish rabbi who during his lifetime never broke a single commandment of the Hebrew scriptures, although he certainly challenged oral traditions, what would make them all of a sudden violate, and soon violate consistently, one of the 10 most central of those commandments, and worship on a Sunday as if something more significant and spectacular actually happened, datable to a Sunday morning? That was what I was trying to say.
All right. Well, for the first time, I think we actually made it through all our questions. Thank you all for your participation. We will now end with a short 3 to 5 minute closing statement from each speaker. Dr. Stecher, will you please start us off?
Sure thing. I guess I'll just talk right from here. Very short summary. I think the historical evidence for the physical resurrection of Jesus falls far short of persuasiveness. The claim of the empty tomb is dependent upon the tale of a suicidal Joseph of Arimathea and a falsified portrait of the Roman thug Pilate, and is totally undermined by the fact that first century Christians did not venerate the alleged location of the foundation miracle of the faith. Paul's testimony is not based upon eyewitnesses, but upon tradition. It is incredibly vague about what the disciples supposedly saw or heard. Paul's own testimony only relates that he heard the voice of Jesus, which nobody else could hear, which hardly inspires confidence. The gospel accounts are undermined by major contradictions as to who saw what and where. These contradictions cannot be reconciled. I invite you to go back to your Bible and look at it again in light of the contradictions that I have pointed out. Furthermore, the Gospels are infected from birth narratives to the end with obvious legends and fictional elements, and I can't see any possibility of knowing where the line goes and on which side the resurrection accounts fall. I've tried to think how my role in this debate might be understood by a traditional Christian. I came up with several ideas, two of which I'll share with you. Both are well within the boundaries of traditional Christian thought. Idea one, God, in his omnipotence, wisdom, and benevolence, has given me the freedom to speak against the resurrection as an established historical fact. In doing so, he has not undermined the faith of his true believers, who will still believe on other grounds. But he has broadened the understanding of all who have participated or witnessed this debate and shown that good people can have different opinions and ideas, can listen to and learn from each other without making moral judgments. Idea two. God has relinquished certain power to Satan. Satan, in turn, has used me, whose mind is naturally turned to evil, to introduce false ideas to weaken the faith of those who are not true believers. Those who, given free will, fall from the faith will be punished eternally in hell, as will I, the tool of Satan. I think I prefer the first idea.
You use all 5 minutes?
As much as I think I need it.
Okay. I didn't prepare a written closing statement because I wanted to see where the conversation had gotten to. So I won't be nearly as eloquent or fluent. But I might suggest there are several other options besides the two you just sketched out. A believing Christian might, to give just one other option, think that God in his sovereignty was using this time to get you to think about one or two things you hadn't thought of before, and maybe me also, and to move us along a trajectory closer to him from wherever we might be today. That could be yet another alternative different from both of your two options. But I think I want to stress 2 points before the gavel falls. I haven't heard anything in any of Carl's, revisionism to account for the utter dramatic transformation of the disciples. This is not somebody who is breathing and who thinks they might have seen Jesus mistakenly, and somebody else happens at a different time, in a different place, and slowly, in a long evolutionary development, the legends of the resurrection appear. Had Jesus been an Athenian, dare I say Socratic in this context, philosopher, who had lived all of his life in Greece, where they believed in the immortality of the soul, and then 30 to 60 years later, the stories finally made it into Israel, where there was a strong belief in bodily resurrection, then that theory of a slow evolutionary legendary development might make some sense. It makes no sense whatsoever coming out of Judaism, coming out of Judaism in Israel, and then being dispersed into places where everything is against belief in a bodily resurrection. I think one of the issues also has to do with the primary and the secondary evidence that we never really talk too much more about. That's a modern construct in a written culture, in a culture of literacy, in a print-based culture. The ancient Mediterranean world was an oral culture. A small minority of people had good reading and writing skills. But there were extraordinary abilities to memorize, word for word, long stories and sacred scriptures, as well as to learn the gist of events, but with a freedom on any given occasion to retell those accounts with great selectivity depending on the purposes at hand. There are entire bodies of literature that study these phenomena in the ancient world. If we don't impose anachronistically modern standards of precision on ancient texts, I mean, would you want to be judged by 41st century standards of precision? Who knows what they will be if we last that long? Then all of these amazing contradictions that Carl has no answer for don't look nearly the same. If you've never looked at a broad cross-section of them, I invite you to look at a book like my work on historical reliability of the Gospels with InterVarsity Press. Decide for yourself. Maybe you won't find the solutions plausible. But at least take a look at what the majority of people throughout history, until the last 100 or 200 years, believed were very plausible resolutions of fairly minor discrepancies.
Thank you. I'd like to thank you all for attending tonight's debate. The speakers and members of the Socratic Club will be around for a few minutes to answer questions. If you would like to receive email announcements of upcoming debates or are interested in joining the Socratic Club, you can sign up in the lobby. We also have some free essays for you and a box where you can submit topic ideas for further debates. I hope to see many of you at our next debate. We should be sending out information on the when and where of that in the next few weeks. Also, I would like to extend an invitation to all of you to drop by the Socratic Club Library. It's a new project of ours that we have in the Talisman Room of the MU, where we have a small collection of books relevant to topics that we have held debates on. It's free. Stop by, browse, check out a book, and bring it back to your leisure. Again, thank you for coming tonight, and please, let's have one more round of applause for our speakers.